Tonight, it is my absolute honor to be introducing tonight's dinner speaker, Steve Moore. Steve Moore is the chairman of the Task Force on Economic Revival at FreedomWorks. In this role, he communicates FreedomWorks' vision for a pro-growth economic agenda to grassroots activists and media nationwide, as well as original economic analysis. Previously, Mr. Moore served as the chief economist, and distinguished visiting fellow in economics at the Heritage Foundation, the largest public policy research institution in Washington, D.C. He served as the senior economic advisor to Donald Trump in 2016, where he helped write the Trump tax plan and worked on energy and budget issues. Mr. Moore has also been a senior economic analyst, with CNN, where he provided daily commentary on the economy, fiscal policy, and politics. From 2014 to 2017, he served as a Fox News contributor. From 2005 to 2014, Mr. Moore served as the senior economics writer for the Wall Street Journal editorial page and as a member of the journal's editorial board. From 1999 to 2004, he also founded the Club for Growth, a 25,000 member organization dedicated to supporting free market tax cutting leaders. In his tenure as president, the Club for Growth became one of the most influential and respected public policy organizations in the nation. Mr. Moore is a frequent lecturer to business, investment, and university audiences around the world on the U.S. economic and political outlook. He particularly enjoys engaging with campus audiences as a part of YAF's campus lecture program. Mr. Moore is a graduate of the University of Illinois, Go Illini, and holds a master's in economics from George Mason University. In 2010, he was awarded the University of Illinois Alumni of the Year Award. Please join me in welcoming Steve Moore.
Back in the room. Wave your hand if you can hear me. Okay, great. Thank you so much for having me. By the way, I did work for Donald J. Trump during the... How many of you like Donald J. Trump? You know, raise your hand. Okay. I did work for Trump. But I have to tell you this, that before I was for Donald J. Trump, I was for Scott Walker for president. And Scott has been truly one of the great governors. And it's thank you for everything you did for the country and for the state of Wisconsin. And what a great leader of YAP. So thank you for having me. Welcome to Washington, D.C. I always call Washington, D.C. America's only work-free drug zone. You'll find that there's a lot of people who don't work very hard in this town, but get very, you know, the thing that's said about Washington that's so true is that people come to Washington to do good and end up doing well. And that's so true. A lot of people get, three of the five wealthiest counties in the United States are here in Washington, D.C. Gee, how did that happen? We don't produce anything, right? All we do is government, and people get rich off of it. So, by the way, Joe Biden wants to make it a lot bigger. And that's why I thought, you remember what one of Donald Trump's closing arguments in the 2016 campaign, I don't know if you all remember this, but his closing argument was drain the swamp. And boy, did people love that message. And we did drain the swamp. Unfortunately, Biden's trying to replenish it. So these are going to be some interesting few months coming up. By the way, before I talk about what's going on now, I'll just say a couple things about Trump, because I was privileged to work for Trump during the campaign when he was running against Hillary. So I got to know him, you know, pretty well. And I'll say this about Trump, that he's certainly, he's one of the most narcissistic people I've ever met. So he's in love with himself, as most politicians are, right? But, you know, he has some incredible qualities. And, he, you know, I think he's a, even when he was doing things that I disagreed with, and I was in the Oval Office with him many times, maybe seven or eight times, I always felt like, and one thing about Trump, you could argue with him. You know, he liked to argue things out, and, you know, he would make his decision. He was the president. And most of the time I would agree with him, and he was good about taking advice, but sometimes he would do what he wanted to do. But I always believed about Trump that every decision he made as president was always about putting America first. I really believe that. And, you know, that's great, right? I mean, right? That's great, right, that he put America first. And I think about that a lot now, Governor, because I'm not so sure this president does. I don't think this president puts America first. And I think he wants to put, you know, the climate change agenda first and all of these other issues first, but not thinking about, will this benefit American workers and will this benefit American companies and American society? And I think part of this is one of the differences between us and them, and I'm presuming that you're all conservatives, is that we really do believe in the idea of American exceptionalism. We believe, as Reagan said, that it was divine providence that put America here as a beacon of freedom for the rest of the world. And I believe that. Do you believe that? Right? I mean, I think it's absolutely true that this is a very special place. And so, but I'll just tell you one or two quick stories about Trump, because he is a lot of fun to be around. And he is kind of, you know, larger than life in a lot of ways. But one of my favorite stories about being with Trump, you know, when he was running for president, was that, you know, he would, you know, I would travel with him, you know, not often, but sometimes he would go on the, you know, on the campaign trail, and he would lead an incredibly exhausting schedule. I think the reason he won is he just outworked everybody. I mean, the guy was just amazing. He is a freak of nature. I don't think the guy sleeps. I mean, maybe 4 hours a day. But, you know, so we would go, you know, literally 3 or 4 or 5 different cities every day, and we'd get, you know, on the plane. You know, we go here or there. And I'll never forget the first time we go on the plane with him, you know, you know, I'm nobody, and there'd be Newt Gingrich and Rudy Giuliani and this senator, that senator, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, he saw me, and I was, and he literally put his big, you know, his arm around me. Hey, Steve, come on, you're going to love this plane, you know, come on up. And he, you know, grabbed me by the shoulder and took me up, you know, the stairs to get on the plane. He's like, do you want to see the cockpit, you know, blah, 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 blah. You know, and he goes, isn't this the greatest plane you've ever been on? You know, I'm like, yeah, I said, I've seen better, you know, but I mean, you know, he's just that way. He's so full of energy. But my favorite part is, like, I thought this is going to be so cool because I'm on a plane. He's got his own plane, and he's a billionaire. So I'm like, this is going to be awesome. We're going to have champagne, and we're going to have caviar, and we're going to have lobster, you know, blah, blah, blah. And every trip we took, the menu was the same. It was Domino's pizza for lunch and McDonald's for dinner. The guy loves fast food. You know, he's a man of the people. So we went to this event. I'll never forget this. And it was a big campaign event, a big dinner with all these muckety mucks. And he's talking, and he loves to hear himself talking. He's going on and on. And it was a dinner, so people were kind of drinking wine and drinking their beers while he's talking. And he just stops in the middle, and he sees this, you know, woman who's about as far away from him as you are to me. And she's just sipping her wine, and he says to this lady, she says, ma'am, she said, do you know that I don't drink? And she was kind of stunned by this, and she said, well, yes, you know, Donald, I've heard that about you. And he goes, can you imagine me if I drank? That was really a very funny thing to say. He's a very funny guy. Okay, so let's get down to economics, okay? Let's talk about what's going on in the world. And what I'm going to try to do is kind of rush you through this. And these slides will be available to you because I know you're kind of the people on campus who are trying to persuade people about the conservative way of life. We know that free enterprise is the goose that lays the golden eggs. It's the reason that America is the greatest country in the history of the world in terms of our economy, is because we have a free enterprise system. And I believe that's in jeopardy right now, and I'm going to kind of walk you through that a little bit. And then, by the way, as I go along, if you have questions or comments, feel free to intervene. So, is this it? Okay. So, Bidenomics. All right. First of all, this is something that's a little depressing. This is what happened last year as a result of COVID. We had all this emergency spending. And for the first time in American history, total government spending in the United States exceeded 50% of our GDP. That's pretty amazing. That means the largest sector of the economy was government, and government actually became larger than all of the private industries combined. So that's kind of scary. That's what socialist countries do, and we don't want that to happen. And I do think one of the mistakes we made is we continued to grow government during COVID rather than, and I'm going to just say this flat out, I believe one of the single greatest mistakes in the history of the United States was when the government shut down our businesses and families and churches and schools, right? It was outrageous. We should never, never do that again. It was a failed experiment. There is no evidence whatsoever. If you compare the states that shut down versus the states that didn't, and by the way, I was just thinking, Wisconsin, that your governor shut shut stuff down, right? The businesses there. Whereas the red states, most of the Republican states, not all of them, but most of the Republican states, anybody here from Florida? You know, you've got the greatest governor in the world. If anybody here from Tennessee or Texas? Well, you have great governor. Anybody from here, from either Utah or Idaho or any of those mountain states, they stayed open. The southern states, how many of you are from the south? Raise your hand. Almost every southern state stayed open. And guess what? The southern states, even when you take into account the latest wave of COVID, had basically no different death rates than states that completely shut their businesses down. So it was an abuse of power, and I hope we never do it again. Okay, so government is out of control today. Government is out of control. And if you look at this, this is showing you this is, by the way, not counting what Biden wants to spend. Okay, this is before Biden's massive spending plan. And you can see the blue line here, these are federal revenues as share GDP going back 30 or 40, 50 years. So you can see our revenues have been pretty constant. They've been coming in at about 17 to 18% of GDP throughout this period. And you can see that even if we do nothing, if we don't pass Biden's tax plan over the next 20 years or so, taxes will go up to about 18.5% of GDP, which is pretty close to an all-time high. So revenues have been constant as a share of our economy. Look at the spending. Look at that spending. And that's not including what Biden wants to spend. So government spending is the problem. The reason we have a deficit is because government is spending too much money. It's not because we're not taxing the rich enough or businesses enough and da-da-da. It's because our spending is way out of control. And in a minute, I'll show you what this looks like if we allow Biden to have his way. Okay. I'm going to skip that one. So the debt, let's say that Biden is able to pass these spending bills that he's got planned. And he has, think about this, by the way. When Biden came into office, we had $1 trillion that was already in the pipeline from a bill that the Trump had signed for COVID relief. So that was $1 trillion that hadn't even been spent that was kind of in the pipeline to be spent when the day that Biden stepped into the Oval Office. The first thing he did was pass a $1.8 trillion blue state bailout. That's what it really was. It was a bailout of the blue states. The red states didn't need money. They had very low unemployment rates. They didn't need money. The blue states did. So it was a transfer of wealth. By the way, the only way the federal government can give money to one state, right, is to take it away from another state, right? It's a zero-sum game. It's not like the federal government has free money. If it gives $1 billion to New York, it has to take the $1 billion from people from other states. You get that? Because there's no, there's not a money machine here in Washington, although they think there is. So look at what happens to the debt if the Biden plan passes. We are right now here on this chart. We're right about here, where our debt is about equal to our entire size of our GDP. Now, that most economists would say that's kind of a danger area once you get to 100%. I don't know how accurate that is, but you don't want to get too much over 100%, right? You're flirting with danger. And there have been books written about how, Greece and Venezuela and Argentina and other countries that have allowed their debt to get out of control, they collapse. And so, this is where you're in the danger zone. And you can see we're already at basically close to an all-time high in American history in terms of our debt. Look at the Biden plan. Look what it does. It just massively increases our debt. And over the next 25 or 30 years, you're talking about the debt hitting 3 times our GDP. That is a recipe for financial disaster, in my opinion. We cannot allow that to happen. And it will happen if Biden's plan passes, because once you get these programs in place, I guarantee you they're very difficult to get rid of. As Ronald Reagan used to say, the closest thing to immortality on this earth is a federal government program. And he was right. I mean, you just can't get rid of these things. So that's why I'm devoting sort of every minute of every day, and I'm sure you are too, Governor, to stop this bill. Kill the bill. We have to. This is not a fire drill. This is the real thing. The left is trying to, as Biden says, he wants to transform America. I don't want to. Who wants to transform America? I kind of like it the way it is. But these are very dangerous. This is a dangerous moment for the country. I just thought I'd show you. Here's like how much Biden, just in his first 100 days in office, how much he spent. And he had that up. That's about $5 trillion. And Governor, look, Obama, remember, we were outraged about how much Obama spent. It was only $1 trillion. And Obama took over during a financial crisis. So the price of poker is going up here, right? Every time we have a crisis, they spend more and more and more money. We're going to skip that one. Okay, here's another point about the budget. You're going to be the world's experts on the federal budget when you're done with this presentation. So I showed you that the problem is not revenues, right? Revenues are, we have enough revenues. Here is defense spending versus non-defense spending. So this is our military spending. This is the Pentagon. And this is everything else. These are the social programs. Does it look like we're spending too much money on defense? Now, look, we could argue, by the way, I think maybe we could cut defense spending. I'm a fiscal conservative. I think there's a lot of waste even in the Pentagon. But that's not the problem, right? Can we agree that's not the problem from this chart? It's all of these social programs that are growing like weeds. And by the way, the defense portion of our budget today has never been smaller than it is in the history of the country. So it is a problem of all these domestic social programs which would grow and grow under Biden. And again, these are numbers without including Biden's debt bills. Okay. Should we spend more money on education? You were one of the great champions of school choice, so thank you for what you did. School choice is so important. Just letting parents have their choice about where they send their kids to school. Is it that complicated, right? Why can't we just let parents shop around? And especially the lowest income, minority parents. I see that there's a number of minorities in this room. Especially for minorities who come from low-income households, giving them options of where they go to school is so important. Now, the left says, no. All we have to do is spend more money, right? I mean, just spend more. Well, look what's happened to spending. These are per-pupil spending. We've almost tripled, in real terms, how much we spend per child on the schools. And yet, is it working? Well, look at the test scores. They're going down and down and down and down. So we're spending more and more. Education might be the only industry in America that has declining productivity. Isn't that amazing? I mean, transportation, we have incredible productivity gains. That's negative. When you spend more and you get worse results, that's the very definition of negative productivity. We put more in when we get less out. And that is because, I'm just going to say it, I think that one of the most evil institutions in America today is the teachers' unions. They are out of control. Okay, so Biden wants to raise taxes. He wants to raise every tax he can get a hold of. And so over the last 30 or 40 years, I'm very lucky. I have worked for two of our greatest presidents. I was lucky to have worked for Ronald Reagan at the end of his presidency in 1987 and 88. And I also worked for Donald J. Trump. And both of them cut tax rates. And they did it to get the economy moving faster. And you can see what Biden wants to do. He wants to move every tax rate higher. And that's a problem, because the higher the tax rates get, the less economic activity you get, right? If you get rates that are higher and higher and higher, people will not work. If you tax something, you get less of it. If you tax something less, you get more of it. Biden wants to raise taxes on investment. He wants to raise taxes on work. And one of the things that I find most troubling, by the way, is this one. Now, this is something most of you don't think a lot about, the death tax, but I'm getting up there in age. I'm 61. And the death tax is basically a tax you pay at death, essentially a tax that you pay, an inheritance tax, essentially. And this is aimed at small family-owned businesses, right? Because one of the hallmarks of America is you can pass your money on to the next generation. I mean, I think about somebody like my dad. When I was growing up, I didn't see my dad a lot. He was a small businessman. He built up a pretty successful business, but he was working 60, 70 hours a week. We didn't see dad a whole lot because he wanted to build up this business. He became an employer. He had 150 employees by the time he retired from his business. But my point is he put his entire sweat equity into that business, and he put every penny he had to grow that business, and he succeeded, and that business grew to be about a $20 million business. And now, under the Biden plan, the government's going to take half of it away from you when you die. You can't pass it on to your kids. I don't know about you. I just think that's un-American. By the way, even Russia and Sweden, which are socialist countries, and communist China, which is a communist country, don't have 40% death tax. So we would have virtually the highest death tax in the world. I think this is reprehensible, frankly. I think it is totally contrary to the American idea of building up, whether it's, how many of you, any of this of you in this room grow up on a farm? Any of you? Where are you?
Washington State.
So was your father a farmer?
No, small farm.
Yeah. So the point is that these farms, you know, a farmer, you know, maybe buys a property for $500,000 and then builds it up over their whole life, and they build, you know, they build the irrigation system, they you know, fertilize the land and all of these things, they build it up, they build a barn, all that stuff. And so now let's say rather than the business being worth $500,000 when they bought it, now it's worth $20 million. That's the American way, right? And we're going to take it away from people. I find that to be highly offensive. Okay. Lower tax rates, I was just talking about this, mean higher revenues, not lower revenues. And this is just a kind of good depiction of this. So when Reagan became president, you can see that brown line, the highest tax rate in the United States was 70%. It's hard to believe we had a 70% tax rate. That meant that every dollar that you made over a certain income level, the government would take 70 cents of it, and you got to keep 30 cents of it. And so, and by the way, in the 60s, the tax rate was as high as 90%. And don't tell Biden that, or he would want us to go back to that. So, you know, think about the impact that that would have on somebody's willingness to work or invest if the government's going to take 90 cents out of every dollar that you earn. And so under Reagan, look what happened when the rates went from 70% down to 50%, then all the way down to 28%. That's a very steep decline in the tax rates. It meant that people now, after tax, got to keep more than twice as much money. And look at the green line. That's the share of taxes paid by the richest 1%. And look at that. Look at that. It's like a paradox, right? The tax rates went down, but the share of taxes paid by the rich went up. Now, why did that happen? Because the economy exploded, right? You want more revenues. The best way to get more revenues is to get more businesses, people working again, earning more money. The more people earn, the more taxes they have to pay. The more businesses that are successful, they pay more taxes. And you can see the tax revenues went up because we lowered rates. Biden is basically saying, he keeps saying, if you notice this government, he keeps saying, the last 40 years have been terrible. Terrible. Oh my gosh, we have to reverse the last 40 years. What happened 40 years ago? That's when Reagan was elected. They're trying to dismantle not just the Trump agenda, in my opinion, the Reagan agenda as well. They want to take us back to the golden days when Jimmy Carter was president. Now, that you guys, you weren't even around when Jimmy Carter was president, but I guarantee you, what I always say is the reason I know that God smiles on America is that Jimmy Carter was not reelected president in 1980, and God gave America Ronald Reagan, and the rest is history. So that's a really dangerous thing, is to be raising tax rates. This is just kind of an interesting one. You know, if raising tax rates is such a great thing as Joe Biden wants to do, why is every other country in the world cutting tax rates? Right? Look at these are the average tax rates, these blue pillars, over the last 25 years. Down, 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 down. These every country, China, Mexico, Europe, you know, Australia, every country. This is the average of all the countries in the world. They kept cutting their tax rates on their businesses. Now, why do you think they did that? Do you think they did that because they love business? No, I can tell you why they were doing that. They were trying to steal jobs from the United States of America. Right? They were saying, hey, come to Bermuda, come to Italy, come to Ireland. Ireland actually has the lowest tax rate in the world. Come to Ireland. I don't know if any of you have ever been to Dublin. Well, a few of you have. It's amazing. Every other business is an American-owned business that's taken advantage of those low tax rates. So the rest of the world was stealing our jobs. I'll never forget, I showed, this is a little bit, there's history behind this chart, because when Art Laffer and I went to go see Trump back in the late 2015, and he just wanted some advice, and we showed him this chart. We said, look at this. Look at this, Donald. We called him Donald back then. Now we call him Mr. President. We said, look at this. Look at what all these countries are doing. And here's our rate up here. And, you know, we now have this big gap. You know, and this is like unpatriotic, you know, to support this, because it's just leading to jobs and businesses and capital leaving the United States and taking advantage of these lower rates. And I'll never forget, Trump kept looking at this chart. And then I think Larry Kudlow said, and therefore we think what you should do, Donald, is you should recommend a 20% corporate rate for the United States. So we're somewhere, you know, down here. So we go from here. And I'll never forget, Trump sits back in his chair and he says, no, no, I don't want to do that. I was like, don't you get this, Donald? You know, this isn't putting America first. We're up here. We got to bring it down to here. He goes, I want 15%. I want 15%. And you'll love this story, actually, Governor. I don't know if you've ever heard Laffer or I tell this, but throughout the next year or so until we got that tax bill passed, every meeting that Trump was in, you know, every time we were together, and he'd go to meet with members of Congress, people in the media, the business community, you know, Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan, and he'd say, I remember he'd say to McConnell and Paul Ryan, don't even bother to give me a, don't even send me a bill if it doesn't have that 15% rate, you know, and I remember, and they're like, wow, he's really committed to this. And so the day that the tax bill passed the Senate, this was in December, it was like December 21st of 2017, or I mean 16. We're very nervous about, I mean 2017, we're thinking, we didn't know if we had all the votes we needed in the Senate to get this bill passed. And we're very nervous, we're waiting in the White House to hear back from Mitch McConnell to see if the Republican caucus would all the Republicans would vote for this bill with a 15% corporate rate. And I'll never forget, McConnell comes into the room, walks right up to the president, Trump, and he says, Mr. President, I'm just so sorry. He said, I have failed you. You know, I did everything I could. I made every argument that you make about why we got to cut this tax rate to 15%. Sorry, Mr. President, I just couldn't get it out of our caucus. He said, I couldn't get you 15%. He said, Mr. President, would you take 20%? And Trump jumps out of it. I'll take that in the New York minute. He was so excited. And I'll never forget that moment because I think Trump wanted that 20% rate all the time. But he is a master negotiator, right? He knows, what's his book? The Art of the Deal. And he knew that if, and I always, now when I say my prayers, I say, thank you, God, that Donald Trump did not take our advice and go at the 20% rate, because we would have ended up at 25. He does know how to negotiate, and so we did get that rate, and by the way, it was a huge success. We just sucked capital in from the rest of the world, and I don't understand why in the world Biden would want to reverse a policy that has clearly worked. Biden wants to double the number of IRS agents. I think that's outrageous. This is one of my favorite little cartoons from Snoopy. Dear IRS, I'm writing to customer. Please take me off your mail list. Wouldn't it be great if we could just all do that? Well, you guys don't. How many of you actually pay taxes? That's pretty good. Huh? You have jobs and you pay taxes. Good. One of my best pieces of advice I can give you while you're in college, get a job while you are in college. Work while you're in college. My experience is, I don't know if you, the people who worked while they're in college did much better later than the people who joined a fraternity sorority and played around. So this might be interesting to you. The rich don't pay their fair share, right? Every single speech Biden gives, every speech he gives, we just want the rich to pay their fair share. Have you all heard him say that? He says it every single, I mean, he said it 15 times. He sounds like Che Guevara. I mean, you know, he just, we're going to pound the rich. We're going to soak the rich. This is the top 1%, and how much do they pay in income tax? 40%. 40%. That's not enough. One out of 100 pay 40%. By the way, the bottom 50% pay 3% of the taxes. 3%. So I want to conceptualize this for you. I'm going to stand right in the middle of this room, okay? Let's say all of you to the left of me, you're in the top 50% of the income in this room. And by definition, that means all of you to the right of me, you're in the bottom 50% of the income in this room. And let's say, you know, you just had this great dinner, right? Great. Was the food good? Did you like it? It was good, right? So let's say now Governor Walker said, well, of course you have to pay for your dinner, right? You have to pay for your dinner. And let's say we pay for the dinner the way our tax system works. The way that would work is that you all on this side of the room, you're the richest 50%, right? So you're going to pay 97% of the tab, and you lucky duckies over here are going to pay 3%. Right? No shifting chairs, by the way. So, I mean, think about that. Now, this young lady, what's your name? Nikki or?
Mickey.
Mickey is the richest. You're the richest person in this room. Okay? You are the richest person in this room. You're not supposed to make fun of people who are disabled. I have a hearing problem, right? So, you are the richest person in this room. So, you're going to pay 40% of the tab yourself. And if Joe Biden, you say, she's not paying enough, right? Come on. I mean, we have a highly, highly progressive tax system that is highly dependent. We probably have the most progressive tax system in the world. In fact, no country in the world depends on the top 1% more than the United States does. Okay, this is kind of a fun one. The states, this is a big deal. You know, we are two countries right now. I mean, I don't say this with any joy, but I believe it is true. We have divided into two countries. We are a nation of red states and we are a nation of blue states. And the red states are states that have Republican governors and for the most part, Republican legislatures. And then the blue states are the states that are run by the Democrats. And occasionally you'll get a great Republican governor like Scott Walker who became the governor. But Wisconsin was a purple state, right? It's kind of moved to being a blue state, although you never know, it kind of moves back and forth. But some of the states are kind of in the middle, but most of them are either, you know, deep blue states like New York and California and Illinois, my home state. And then you can see, I don't know how well you can read this, but what this is showing is just where are people moving to, okay? Because, you know, you can tell a lot about a place by whether people are moving to it or moving from it, right? People move to desirable places and they move away from undesirable places. So look at how many, Florida, again, how many Florida residents? I mean, where are you in Florida?
Orlando.
Okay, Orlando, where are you from?
Orlando.
So, I mean, Florida is just an amazing state. It has beautiful, you know, great weather, but it also has, anybody know what the income tax rate is in Florida? Zero. Okay. Texans. Texans, raise your hand again. Texas. Where are you from?
Houston.
So, anybody know what the income tax rate is in Texas? Zero. Anybody here from Tennessee? Where?
Nashville.
Yeah. Both of you? Okay. What's the income tax rate in Texas, Tennessee? Zero. You get the point here? Now, you know, these states are the states that, look at the migration. 1 million people over the last decade, 1.3 million people have moved to Florida on net from other states. The same thing, Texas. By the way, Texas overtook Florida. It used to be Texas was number one. Now Florida's taking it because they got a really good governor, but you both have good. But look at this. People are moving to these red states. Now look at the, who here is from New York? I'm sorry. I mean, New York, 1.5 million people have moved out of New York. It's just so sad. Illinois, I know you're a lot, because we, you know, Illinois is just, you know, melting down. It's unbelievable. I love the state of Illinois. I think Chicago is one of the great cities in the world. It is being destroyed by the politicians. You know, same thing with Michigan. Any Michiganders here? One or two. And then, any Californians in this room? Wow. How do you ruin California? You know, it is the most beautiful place on the planet, right? I mean, the most beautiful beaches, the most beautiful, you know, weather, the most beautiful mountains, the most beautiful women. I mean, what's not to like about California? And yet 1 million people are leaving California. It's unbelievable. So, you know, I was debating, any of you know who Paul Krugman is? He was a very famous kind of left-wing economist, and I was debating him a few years ago, and I showed him this chart, you know, because we were debating whether free markets work and Republican policies work better than Democratic Party, and I showed him this, and I said, well, Paul Krugman, you have a Nobel Prize, and you're a really smart guy. You're at MIT, and I know I have a much smaller brain than you do, but if your policies work so well, why are all the people moving to the states that have Republican governors, and they're moving away from the governors that take your advice, you know, like California, Illinois, and Michigan, and so on. And he said, Steve, there's a good reason why people are moving to these red states. He said it's because of the weather. Now that's stupid because you know Florida has really nice weather, right? And so does South Carolina, and so there's no doubt about it. The weather does have a big factor. But I really zinged him. I said, well, gee, you know, Governor, Professor Krugman, I guess I see what you're saying, but if it's because of the weather, then why are people moving from, you know, San Diego moving to Houston, right? Because nobody moves from San Diego to Houston for the weather, but they move there for economic opportunity. And so, you know, blue states are, Democrats just destroy everything they touch with okay. Energy. I think one of the dumbest things that Joe Biden is doing, and there are a lot of dumb things he's doing, but this might be one of the worst. This is our energy production. We've lived through, in the last 15 years, one of the most miraculous energy revolutions in the history of the world. And it came because of something called shale oil and gas. Fracking, horizontal drilling, amazing innovations in terms of how we get to the oil and gas and how we extract it. And so, you know, the Permian Basin is now, you know, practically the richest oil field in the world. There's at least 150 years worth of, we're not running out of this stuff, right? We're running into it. We have so much oil and gas. And so you can see the massive increase in production. We tripled. In the last 15 years, we tripled the amount of oil and gas we produce, which is incredible, really an incredible accomplishment. And it wasn't just Texas, it was West Virginia, it was Pennsylvania. Anybody here from Pennsylvania? Pennsylvania has been in West Virginia. I don't know if anybody's here from West Virginia. These states, North Dakota, I bet there's nobody here from North Dakota, but you are? Wow, where are you from?
South Dakota, Vermilion.
Okay, wow, wow. Anybody here possibly from Oklahoma? No Oklahomans. But these are states that are producing incredible amounts of energy. And so we're, let's look at this. In the year that Trump, in 2020, Trump's last year in office, for the first time in American history, or not American history, but in any of our lifetimes, and I'm 62, the United States became a net exporter of oil and gas. Think about that. Think about that. We OPEC was dead, right? Because we were producing more oil and gas. This is Saudi Arabia. We were producing more than they were. This is Russia. We were producing more than they were. Here's the Biden energy plan, Governor. Does that make any sense? I mean, it's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. We have more of this stuff than any other country in the world. And we're not going to produce it? Now, look, I'm not against windmills. I'm not against solar panel. If you live in any Arizonans in the room. Yeah, I mean, Arizona, solar power probably makes a lot of sense in Arizona, right? There's a lot of sunshine. But I guarantee you, being from Chicago, it doesn't make a lot of sense in Chicago to have solar power, right? Although some people do use it. But my point is, you can use, these are niche forms of energy. You know, they could maybe provide 5 or maybe even 10% of our energy. But I'm here to tell you, you're not going to be able to provide enough energy for a $24 trillion economy that makes steel, and that makes, you know, cars, and makes manufactured goods, and makes technology, and all, houses, and construction. We're not going to be able to make $24 trillion with windmills. You just can't. You're not going to be able to do it. That's impossible. So the only way you can do it is to totally depress the economy. So what I want to see in energy policy is this line going up. The only people who benefit from this are Vladimir Putin and the Saudi oil sheiks, right? They love Joe Biden. They love Joe Biden. He's going to put them right back into business. So this is not what I would call an America First energy policy, right? This is an America Last energy policy. Now, some of you may say, well, wait a minute. Steve Moore, don't you understand? We have pollution. We have climate change. We have to stop using fossil fuels. Well, here's the record of our air quality over the last 30 or 40 years. Does it look like pollution is going up? Pollution is one of the great miracles of America of the last 40 years is how much we've cleaned up the air. And by the way, these are real pollutions. Lead. People get sick from lead. Carbon monoxide. By the way, carbon monoxide is a pollution. Carbon dioxide is not a pollution. You don't get sick from carbon dioxide. By the way, without carbon dioxide, there's no life on Earth. All of these things, dramatic reductions in pollution levels. And even carbon dioxide. Can anybody tell me in this room which country in the world, of all the 50 major industrialized countries, which country over the last 5 years has reduced its carbon emissions the most? United States. How many of you knew that? Raise your hand if you knew. Oh, come on. Did you really? Are you? I mean, because most Americans haven't. I bet most 90% of Americans don't know that. We've reduced our carbon emissions more than any other country, more than all these sanctimonious European countries who care so much about climate change, blah, blah, blah. And it's just the truth we have. Now, here's the second question for a follow-up, for a free autographed copy of my book, Trumponomics. Why? How have we reduced our carbon emissions? It's a two-word answer. Who said natural gas? Ding, 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 ding. Give us natural gas. It turns out natural gas is a wonder fuel. It's cheap. It's abundant. It's made in America, it's reliable, and it is clean burning. So somebody, Governor, really, why are they against natural gas? I mean, really, why? I mean, it makes no sense. There's another form of energy that we get a lot of our energy from that emits no carbon. What's that? Nuclear power. If you really cared about, if let's say that God ordained, you have to stop using fossil fuels. Let's say no more fossil fuels, ever, ever, ever. What would we do? What would the smart thing to do? Would it be to pave the whole planet with windmills and solar panels? No. We'd build 100 nuclear power plants, right? And we would have enough energy. But they don't want to do that either. So I'm not so sure that they really care about climate change all that much. I think they're interested in just deindustrializing America. This is the Trump policies. Look at this. We cut taxes. We cut regulation. This stuff really works. Look at what happened. This is median income in the United States. We had the best three-year record of increasing income ever. $68,000 a year, up from $62,000 in just 3 years. Amazing. Historically low unemployment under Trump when we cut taxes and cut regulation. This isn't complicated, right? When we see Trump, we'd show him that this stuff is even working better than we thought it would. Inflation was low. No, I'm not going to speed through this. I'm coming to an end here. I just find this to be an interesting economic lesson. These are inflation rates for all the various different, this is kind of, sorry about this, there's some muddled up, but you know, these are inflation rates for all the different kinds of things that we buy, you know, and you know, when you see the consumer price index, that's the amalgamation of all the different products, but every industry has its own rate of inflation. And you know, if you look at actually most kind of items like cars, apparel, furniture, computers, technology, they're falling in price, which is great, until Biden became president. Now prices for everything are going up. But look at the two industries over the last 20 years where prices have gone up the most. Those are the two on the far left, education and healthcare. Now, I've got one more book that is autographed, ready for one of you to win. What do education and healthcare have in common? Yeah. What'd you say? Okay. No, I'm not calling on you. Yes, sir.
They both have increasing overhead, so administrators and stuff.
They both have what?
Increasing overhead.
No, that's not the right answer. Yes, sir.
Subsidies.
What?
Subsidies.
Subsidies? Sort of, but that's not exactly the answer. Let me put it. Okay, go ahead.
Is it they're both paid for by taxpayer dollars?
Government, right? These are the two industries in America that government runs, right? I mean, every other industry, the government doesn't run the auto industry, well, under Biden, but it doesn't now. Furniture, you don't have a government furniture department or a government computer department or a government housing department. Well, we do have a housing department. But food, you know, these are things that are run by the private sector. What happens? Boosting productivity, and they do better and better. The two industries that are run by government have the biggest rate of inflation. Now, here's the funny thing. When I ask my liberal friends, and I do have liberal friends, I always say, gee, why do we have the government play such a big role in education and healthcare? And incidentally, you could make the case these are maybe the two most important industries of all, right? We have to have educated children, and we also have to have, you know, healthcare to keep us alive. So these two vital industries, we have the government run these. And I always ask my friends, my liberal friends, why do we do that? And they say, we have to do that to make it affordable. I'm like, gee, they're doing a great job of it, right? You know, those are the areas where the price is out of control. Okay, I'm almost done. I'm going to end on this one, and then we'll take a few questions, and then you guys can get back to the hotel. America, this great country of ours, is not a systemically racist country. America is not a systemically racist country. And shame on this president for saying that. Now, that's not to say we don't have a racist past. We do. We have a lot of sins as a country. We paid a high price of it. Have there been Jim Crow laws? Yes. Have there been segregation? Yes. Was there slavery? Yes. 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 Were there horrible things? Yes. 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 And we should never forget. There's stains on our history. But America today, I'm going to make the case to you, is the least racist country on the planet. And the reason for that is, well, just think about that. This. Where is the one country everybody wants to come to? Right here. You know, the Africans want to come to the United States. The Mexicans want to come to the United States. The Hispanics in South America want to come to the United States. The Haitians want to come to America. They don't want to go to Germany. They don't want to go to France. They don't want to Italy. These are people of color. Where do they want to come? Here, here. Why would they want to go to a racist country? Why would they want to do that? So now, here's the evidence of this. This is pretty amazing. And you might not believe this, so you can look it up, because the numbers are really pretty astounding. These are the ethnic groups in America that have the highest income. And it's not whites. Did you know that? It's not whites. What ethnic group has the highest income in the United States?
Asians
do. And I see a lot of Asians in this room. Asians are doing amazingly. So I looked at Indian America. Any Indian Americans in this room? Are there any? Because I see some Asians. Indian Americans have a median income in the United States of $120,000. That's amazing. Chinese Americans. How many? I know there's some. Just one. You're the only Chinese American here. Almost $100,000 of income. A median. Median. Filipinos. Any Filipinos? Chinese, Japanese, they do amazingly well. And by the way, Asians are people of color, right? Asians have brown skin. They're making more money than white Americans do, which is really pretty incredible. Immigrants do incredibly well when they come to this country. Here's another really interesting one, is Hispanic Americans. Now, Hispanic Americans do have lower incomes than whites do, but the fastest growth of income of any group over the last 10 years has been Hispanics. Hispanics are doing really well. Blacks, African Americans are not doing as well as they should. And I don't have a good explanation for that. I mean, I don't know if it's racism or what, but we need to do a better job of rising. You know, I believe what John F. Kennedy said, that we need a rising tide that lifts all boats. Not, as you know, Art Lapper would say, a good economic system does not try to make rich people poor, it tries to make poor people rich. And all I'm hearing from Biden is slash the rich, eat the rich, hate the rich. It's like, did you ever see that Batman movie with Bane? And you know, it's like havoc in the city of New York, New York, and it's, oh my God, everybody's, you know, shooting at each other and blah, blah, blah. It's like total chaos. And then Bane's giving this speech about like, oh, hey, we hate the rich. We're not going to get successful by tearing down the people who are successful. So this is, and by the way, I believe the two things that would be the best things we could do for black Americans today would be, number one, school choice for every black child in America. Let them go to good schools. And the second is let African American workers, let every worker under the age of 30 put your Social Security money into a personal private account so you can build that up over time and you can make a lot of money. And I promise this is the last chart I'm going to show you. This is the greatest story ever told. And this is what has happened to the wealth of Americans. And this is an incredible story. Look at, this is the stock market. This is the stock market. It has been, you know, that's why I laugh when Joe Biden says, the last 40 years have been terrible, terrible for America. Okay, I got one more book. Okay, so this is the last one. And anybody, whoever comes closest, I will give the book to, autograph. Does anybody know what the Dow Jones Industrial Average is today? Any of you know? It's about 35,000, a little bit below 35,000. Okay, so keep that data point in mind. The Dow Jones Industrial Average is at 35,000. Does any of you know, anybody want to take a guess, 40 years ago, the day Ronald Reagan became president, do you know this one, Governor? What the Dow Jones Industrial Average was 40 years ago? Take a guess, what do you think? One third of what it is today?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good guess. So you're saying like it'd be at like 10,000 then? Is that?
Probably less than that.
What's that?
Probably less than that.
Yeah. All right. What do you think?
3,000.
3,000. Pretty good. Any other?
450.
What?
450.
So you guys are pretty close, actually. So 40 years ago, the Dow Jones Industrial Average was 1,000. So think about that. It went from 1,000, not to 3,500. It didn't triple. It went up 30-fold. This is the greatest period of wealth creation in the history of civilization. We've never seen anything like that. And just imagine if you're in my generation, when we were 25, they said, you can put your Social Security money into the stock market. Every American would be a millionaire. Every single American would have, every single African American worker, Hispanic worker, Chinese worker would have $1 million in these accounts. Albert Einstein used to say, this is one of life's great lessons, okay? The most powerful force in the universe is compound interest. The compounding effect of a stock market going from 1,000 to 35,000, amazing, incredible. This means you put 1,000 in, you know, back then, and with all the returns, you're talking about like practically $1 million 40 years later. So my advice to you, and I'll stop with this, is if you want to get rich, start investing in America early. If you get, you know, just take 10% of everything you earn from now until forever and just put it in an index fund of the stock market, and you will be really, really, really rich when you retire. Okay, I'm done. Thank you very much. It looks like we got, 3 minutes or so for some quick questions. So fire away.
Yeah. Okay, 2 questions, all right? I see 2 right there. Say your name and your school. No follow-ups.
Yeah.
Is this on? Oh, here it is.
Go ahead.
Hi, my name is John Jennings, and I'm from George Mason University.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So basically, towards the end, what you were saying was about you want everyone to be rich,
yes.
And then over time, hopefully, like, everyone becomes rich. So my question is, if everyone is a billionaire and everyone's like a millionaire, wouldn't the consumer prices also just go up to that, and it wouldn't theoretically...
Okay, so that's a good question. What happens if everybody gets richer? Well, let me just show you a chart that I passed over because I think it's an interesting one. It's sort of to the beginning of this. So this is from 2005. So this is like 15 years old, but it's really kind of amazing. These are poor households in the United States. And what poor households have, 99.7% of poor households have a refrigerator. 50 years ago, even a lot of rich people didn't have refrigerators. Television, you know, 98% of poor people have televisions. 60 years ago, there weren't even televisions. Stoves and ovens. Look at this. As a country gets richer, the things that we have are not just available to the rich people, they're available to everyone. So under the scenario where we just keep creating more and more wealth, no, everybody gets richer. And by the way, as wealth builds, things don't get more expensive. The way you build wealth, the way an efficient economy works is you produce more and more and more things at lower and lower prices, right? Think of Walmart. Think of computer technology. The amount of that you can produce in terms of information. Let me just give you one example. When I first came to this town, my first job was a research assistant, and I used to have to work at the Library of Congress. You know, I got to go into the stacks, and I'd actually have to look up, like, you know, oh, where did this statistic come from? Or find out, you know, how many Hispanics have, you know, this or that or the other thing. And I'd spend all afternoon, literally, looking for just little pieces of information. And I'd go into the stacks, I'd find books, I'd look up the... You all can go on the internet and find this stuff in like 3 seconds, right? So it used to take me 3 hours to find information out that you can find with a click of a button. Think about that. That's so incredible. And so, by the way, we were just talking about one little funny story. Paul Krugman, who's this Nobel Prize winning left-wing economist who writes 3 days a week for the New York Times. You're not going to believe this, Governor. He said that in 1996, he wrote, the internet will have no bigger impact on the American economy than the fax machine did. I mean, is that the dumbest thing you've ever heard? So, you know, we live in a society where, yes, everybody can be rich, and all we have to do is get the policies right. Yeah. Hi.
John Carter, Liberty University, and I have a military spending question for you. So the Pentagon has reported, and I've seen personally, that military departments...
So the Pentagon has what?
The Pentagon has reported, and I've seen personally that they spend lots of money. They've reported that they've spent hundreds of billions of dollars through their use it or lose it policy, where basically at the end of every fiscal year, you know, military departments will have to spend whatever money they have in their budget, and that's added up to hundreds of billions per every fiscal year. My question for you is, has that policy ever been questioned or... modified in every way.
To spend the money.
Yeah.
Year. This is a great point that you're making. So what we do in Washington, I don't know if you did this in Wisconsin, but you know the way the government works, because most governments do this. If we give like an agency like $100 billion a year, and let's say through like the first 2/3 of the year, now they still have only spent half the money. You know what the agency has to do? has to spend the $50 billion that they don't even need in the last three quarters of the year. So they have party, I mean, how crazy is it? I don't know. Is that how you did it in Wisconsin? I mean, this is the way it worked. Yeah, you had zero-based budgeting and things like that. Now, you can't make this stuff up. We could easily save. Do you know how many government programs Joe Biden wants to get rid of in his budget that increases spending by $5 trillion? You know, take a guess. Somebody said zero. No, you know what one program that Biden wants to get, I wonder if you can guess what program he wants to get. We have a Washington, D.C. scholarship program for low-income people to go to private school. It's like $40 million, which is nothing in the budget. That's the program he wants to kill. That's the program. And doesn't that tell you everything? The only program he wants to kill is one that gives, and by the way, 95% of the kids who get those scholarships are African Americans, the other 5% are Hispanics, and that's the program he wants to kill. We need to go through the entire federal budget, and we need to wipe out all the things we don't need. I believe that we could save 30 cents on every dollar. Do you think that's about accurate, 30 cents of every dollar? And then we wouldn't have to have all these taxes, right? All right, anything else before we close off? Is that it?
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you guys. Have a great night. Great to be with you.